But I would speak, I would like to say a word on Black Millerites.
Mm.
Because we've been discovering more Black Millerites, and there were a greater number of Blacks who embraced that movement than we heretofore thought.
Mm.
And interestingly, and this is something that Doug Morgan, Samuel London, and other Adventist historians have picked up on and they've been exploring, and that is, what is it about Adventism? And for that matter, what is it about Millerism that attracted Blacks who were active in social justice?
Mm.
What is it about Millerism? What is it about Adventism that has always attracted Blacks who are interested and who are social justice activists?
Mm.
When we look at Adventism, we know that some of the greatest civil rights figures were at one time associated with Adventism.
Mm.
Like Sojourner Truth?
Sojourner Truth with Millerism.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, with Adventism, we have people like Mary Britton, mm. Arna Bontemps of the Harlem Renaissance, Malcolm X
mm-hmm.
was at one time a Seventh-day Adventist, and of course his mother, she was a magnificent civil rights activist within her own right.
Mm-hmm.
We have T.R.M. Howard, William Patterson, some of the Tuskegee Airmen
mm.
were Seventh-day Adventists. We have Frederick Douglass's daughter,
mm-hmm.
Rosetta Douglass Sprague was a Seventh-day Adventist.
Mm.
Holds true for the Millerite movement as well. Atante mentioned Sojourner Truth.
Mm-hmm.
Sojourner Truth attended Millerite camp meetings
mm-hmm.
and she spoke at Millerite camp meetings.
Mm-hmm.
And she was counted among the Millerites. There is some confusion on that because after 1844, there was a great embarrassment with Millerism, obviously.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Because Jesus did not come. And so people mocked Millerite. I mean, they were a byword.
Mm.
And so when Sojourner Truth published her first autobiography, her first biography, she wanted to somewhat distance herself from a movement that didn't pan out.
Mm. Right, right.
But she still has a rather lengthy chapter for that book
mm.
On, what is it, among the Adventists? I think among the Second Adventists?
Mm.
Mm-hmm.
And so she talks extensively about her time with the Millerites, and her biographer, Nell Irvin Painter, points out that it was among the Adventists, and that's what they were called.
Mm-hmm.
The Millerites were called Adventists, Adventists and Millerites.
Mm-hmm.
But she says it was among the Second Adventists that Sojourner Truth found her calling in life.
Mm.
Mm.
It was where she became actualized.
Mm. Yeah.
Well, the Adventists, I mean, she was already a Christian preacher.
Mm-hmm.
She was already a Christian preacher. And when you look at the experience of Blacks, whether free or slaves, in the 1830s and 40s, they were already apocalyptic.
Mm.
Blacks had a built-in apocalypticism or a built-in eschatology,
yeah.
A built-in kind of a last day thinking. We recall Frederick Douglass in the Leonid media shower of 1833 when the stars fell. Frederick Douglass was enslaved, but he still said, I took this as an omen
mm.
of the coming of Jesus.
Mm. Mm. Wow.
When the stars fell, and he said, I welcomed him as my savior, and Blacks saw the second coming of Jesus as a remediation,
mm.
as a correction of the failed American political system.
Mm.
In other words, the American promise that all men are created equal, and guaranteed you know, these rights, life, liberty, pursuit of happiness, what have you, that has failed Blacks. And they're seeing all of, you know, there's this movement that is arising to give them freedom. But, you know, in the 1830s and 40s, that's still a long way off. So even that movement is failing. So Jesus will stop it. Jesus will end this dark period of captivity and suppression. And so even in 1833, Frederick Douglass realized that when he was enslaved, of course, Nat Turner and his rebellion, it was steeped in apocalypticism. You know, he almost seemed to think of his rebellion as the last days, as
the beginning of the apocalypse.
That would bring on the apocalypse. And this was rife later in Seventh-day Adventist thinking. When you read Ellen White's comments on the Civil War, it's almost like she's saying that the Civil War would end in the second coming of Jesus. You should read some of her statements. You know, she almost thought like this is it. Probably like some of us think that COVID and some of the current race wars will usher in the second coming. But that is that is rife in early Adventist literature, that the second that racial issues will usher in the parousia, the second coming of Jesus.
Yeah.
In Millerism, we have more Black activists besides Sojourner Truth. We have William Still, the so-called forefather, the father of the Underground Railroad. Still was a Millerite. Even after 1844, of course, we know that Millerism, that Adventism continued after 1844. And I'm not talking about Sabbatarian Adventism. I'm not talking about what became the Seventh-day Adventist Church. I'm saying Millerism continued on in many forms. Of course, Joshua Himes, how many periodicals did he keep going, Kev? Probably two?
Something like that, yeah.
Yeah. And so William Still, the father of the Underground Railroad, he remained an Adventist, a Millerite, for the rest of his life. And he was donating to Millerite causes. And he says very clearly, listen to this. He says very clearly that the belief in the near advent, the soon advent of Jesus, has informed my work with the Underground Railroad. It has powered my work with the Underground Railroad. Now, many Adventists, even today, Seventh-day Adventists, act like we can't chew gum and walk at the same time. It's a very extremely disingenuous argument because they say, well, we can't do both. We can't witness for Jesus, you know, give our message and be involved in, you know, anti-Black racism, you know, overthrowing anti-Black racism at the same time. And you know, many people who are saying this aren't even witnessing. I mean, they're not witnessing much for the Advent. I mean, let's be honest. You know, I mean, it's sort of like an armchair, you know, they're keyboard warriors. You know, I mean, they're in front of their computers, you know, making these comments. So they're not doing either. Not witnessing for the Adventist faith or you know, doing racial activism. They're not doing either. But Adventists have always been able to walk and chew gum at the same time. And we have some prominent Black Millerite ministers like John W. Lewis and William Watkins. Of course, William Still and others who were Millerite ministers. They were Millerite ministers. And they were activists. They were social justice activists at the same time. Oftentimes, they would have Millerite periodicals, you know, Millerite literature, and Garrison's Liberator. Abolitionist anti-slavery literature. At the same time, you know, they're passing out both. And so these things are intertwined, they're indissoluble. And the Blacks and Millerites, one thing that you need to understand about Blacks and Millerites is that Blacks were not just Millerites, they created Millerism, along with others. Mm. We have a Black Millerite prophet named William Foy. Black Millerite leaders, like I just mentioned, John W. Lewis and William Still. So they were, and they donated funds to the cause, expanded the racial parameters of the cause. So they were a part of the warp and woof of Millerism, and they created Millerism. One other thing we need to realize is that at times, and this is rather rare, what I don't know if you use the term rare, but at times Millerism did penetrate the South. Millerites were largely persona non grata in the South because they were anti-slavery and abolitionist, and because, you know, already there was a gulf forming between sort of the Northern mindset, the Northern culture, and the Southern mindset and culture. But when Millerism did enter the South, whether through publication, whether through Millerite preachers, there were Black enslaved Millerites who preached. And interestingly, the Millerite message always equated to a proclamation of freedom. So Black slaves always embraced it as a message of liberation. There were a couple of instances in which, I think it was Louisville, Kentucky, the one I'm thinking of, when Millerism was preached and a white slave owner heard the message and emancipated his Black slaves.
Wow.
And so it's almost like you hear the Millerite message and you immediately... You do the most woke thing you can do for the time.
Benjamin.
You free your slaves.
Yeah. I'm going to put this question to you, and I know I already have a question on the table.